Friday Get Down is later on. That's going to be especially exciting for Mary, since, you know, there's that half a second of just anticipation and suspense with the Friday Get Down. That little lag time, even here in the room, between when the sound starts coming out of Bill and when it hits your ear.
Mm-hmm.
And that's going to be even, if you'll pardon the pun, that's going to be even more amplified.
Now, Mary, you say that it's your favorite segment of the week. Is it because it turns you on so much?
No. Where did you get that from? I don't think that turns anybody on.
Speak for yourself, Mary.
You all slippery out?
Okay. I mean,
men don't work that way.
I wouldn't speak for yourself, Bill. I wouldn't say slippery. But just the mere mention of it right now, that reminds me that it's coming up. Let's say
that's my job, is
Misty.
To get people off.
My excitement is that my weekend gets to start at 3 p.m.
Because she's on the West Coast. That's what they call a time difference.
I'm in a new time. I'm on the Pacific Standard Time.
Right.
The old PST, right? Yeah.
Yes, you are on
that
Pacific
PST.
Standard Time. Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to be getting crazy.
All right.
Doing what?
Even before you guys.
Yeah, what will happen? What time is the show? Are you doing two shows tonight?
Two shows tonight, one at 7, one at 9:30. They're both sold out. So in between.
So what will you, yeah, here, what will you do? You'll have a considerable amount of time between the end of this show and the beginning of your stand-up tonight.
But there's nothing to do in a place like San Diego.
Hours. Yes, it's just so boring here.
And
you know what I mean? There's like,
you're not near anything in your condo,
no,
so it's like,
my condo
blech.
Is just like, oh, what, next to sand? Cool, you know?
Well, you missed yesterday's show, so I would suggest that you stay inside and listen to yesterday's show all the way through.
You're
and
right,
please submit me your notes, okay? Thank you.
Okay.
Will you surf at all?
No, but you know what is so funny? This morning I woke up and I look out my bedroom window and I was like convinced I saw a seal. I was like, oh my God, there's a seal. It's so close to the shore. That's amazing. And I was like going to go run out onto the beach. And it was just a stupid surfer. I was like, dude, what are you doing? It was like 8:30 in the morning and some guy's out there in a wetsuit surfing.
Well, yeah. You're just burning daylight.
That's the Salt Lake.
But why would you not be excited to see somebody out there surfing? I mean, that's...
There were no big waves.
That's an art. They're out there waiting for them.
Yeah, but wouldn't you rather see a seal? Like up close and personal right at the edge of the
beach? You can go to a zoo and see a seal.
I can go anywhere and see a man.
Not surfing.
He wasn't surfing. He was sitting on a surfboard.
With due respect to the Cleveland surfing community, it's not San Diego.
Do less.
Oh, he was sitting there waiting.
Yes, he was like on his belly.
I see. He wasn't in a tasty barrel or anything like that. He wasn't.
No.
I see.
How would that look like a seal?
Because he had on like an all gray wetsuit.
What was the color of the board, though?
I didn't see the board. Unless it was also gray or black, I only saw his body. Maybe he wasn't even surfing. Maybe he was just swimming in a wetsuit. I don't know. I can't imagine the water's very warm in January.
Hmm. In San Diego?
I haven't been to the beach yet.
Oh. So that's what you'll do?
Yeah, I want to go just sit on the beach and read.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I want to do.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's what I'll do in between now. Or I might take a nap. I don't know.
I'll either sit on the beach and read or take a nap. Those are really the two extremes in thought there. You know, I'm mm-hmm. going to be out in nature. I want to avail myself
Can't
of the
you take
environment.
A nap on the beach?
I could take a nap on the beach. And it is awesome because I can open the window to the condo, to the bedroom, and I can hear the waves. And there was a guy playing like reggae music last night at sunset. And I was like, man, I'm never leaving. This is perfect.
And the beauty part is, you know, San Diego, no homeless. So, boy, that's the...
Not where I am.
I was joking. That's the best part.
No, I'm saying there aren't any where I am.
Oh.
Yeah, well, she's in the nice part.
Oh, she was being serious.
Yeah.
I see.
Yeah. I'm in La Jolla.
Understood, yeah. So they've probably kicked them all out, right?
I guess.
Get over to the public sidewalk, Skel.
Yeah.
Alan, I'm a paramedic, and I worked a Meatloaf concert years ago, and he's the only person we had to take care of. The guy sucked down three of our oxygen bottles during the performance. I thought he was going to croak right there.
Well, he's got big songs with a lot of vocal, you know, he's got to be able to sing his songs.
That's why I give the guy credit.
I need an oxygen after I do the Friday Get Down. I could use one of those. Bring one over.
I can't believe he made it to 74. I can't believe COVID. For anybody who thinks COVID is like, you know, whatever. COVID is what got Meatloaf, who spent 50 years running around as a fat ass and singing his ass off and sucking down oxygen bottles as he goes off stage in like a full-on white frilly suit. That is no easy thing to do. But he made it happen.
And he made it look easy.
Just couldn't get past COVID.
And he did it with style. He did it with a little...
a little spring in his step?
Yeah.
What was that? He did what?
Je ne sais quoi.
I don't think that's what that means.
He's got that thing.
That's not it at all. Do less. Get down. Try less. Do it again. Hop up. Nope. Too slow. Do less. Hop up. Pop up.
This is the surfer this
morning. You're doing too much. Do less. Pop down. Pop up now. Stop. Get down. Get down.
See, that's Paul Rudd trying to teach Jason Segel how to surf. What was his name? Paul Rudd had like an island name, or he's just like a...
Kanu or something.
But he moved there and took
like,
a name.
He's like, oh, how'd you get that name? He's like, on the internet. The weather outside is weather.
Tell Mary to go to Pacific Beach. That's where all the action and the homeless are.
That's where I'm staying. I'm staying on the ocean in Pacific Beach. I haven't seen any homeless.
Could it be that they knew you were coming, and this is their version of rolling out the red carpet for you? You know, like when they had the Super Bowl in Detroit many years ago. It was the Steelers and the Seahawks, and boy, they took every possible precaution to make sure that the homeless people. They built like fake storefronts so they could stick homeless people in there, so people walking around from all over the country weren't going to be inconvenienced by homeless people.
Well, it's also cold, so that's got people probably going to the beach. Probably isn't the best place to hang out when it's that cold.
Well, in the Pacific Ocean's always cold anyway. So,
but like when the air is 40 degrees,
it's 64 right now.
I know, but I'm saying like last night. So like when you were there. There's probably not a ton, even 64 to people in California, they're like, huh, enough of this.
It's not beach weather for sure. But here's the other thing that I was going to say is that I am not positive who's a surfer and who's homeless because they all kind of just have dreads. And there was a guy doing yoga on the boardwalk this morning.
Oh, yeah, those are homeless people.
Well, that's what I was saying. He's like buff, like he was fit and he was drinking a green juice. But he also had on like tattered shorts and was just in the middle of the walkway doing yoga. So
right,
I don't know what this is.
That's the confusing part is when the yoga instructor asks you for spare change. Mm-hmm. That's what gets people's heads all messed up.
And then as I was walking by to go get a breakfast sandwich, there was one guy. Okay, so I think I did see one homeless person. He had a skateboard and he was yelling about Stuart Little.
The movie?
The I book?
Definitely a homeless guy.
A friend named Stuart Little. I don't know. But he was very upset about Stuart Little.
My name is Terry Little, and my brother has never been found.
Stuart!
I demand justice for Stuart. He's very, very small, and he drives a red convertible. And the San Diego Police Department has been less than forthcoming with the developments in his case. Alan, my name is Michelle, and my brother nicknamed me Mitch the Witch. And as I got older, I became Mitch the Bitch. I got the last laugh, though, because he died when he was 23.
Oh, boy.
Wow. That took a sharp left turn. I got the last laugh.
Yeah. Take that, brother.
Uh-huh.
She didn't like that nickname.
Somebody else says, I'm 4'11", and my friend's husband calls me Booster Seat.
Booster Seat.
That's funny.
I don't get it. Just because they're so short?
They're so small.
Yeah, they have to use booster seat to ride in the car or to drive.
I see.
Or sit in a booth at a restaurant.
They're not using her as a booster seat.
No, she needs one.
Oh, I thought there was some sex thing in there or something. Yeah. Hey, Mike. Hello.
Hey, Alan. How you doing?
What's up?
I wanted to ask you if you remembered Meatloaf from a movie called Roadie. Because I think that's where I was introduced to him.
Roadie.
It was a movie from the 70s. And
no.
I think the band that he was a roadie for was Cheap Trick. And it was just a bit part, and he was the roadie, and that was where I was introduced to Meatloaf, and I was surprised that you guys hadn't referred to that. You don't know it, huh?
That doesn't ring any bells. This is a movie he was in.
Yeah, I remember watching it on cable as a kid, like at home, you know?
Yeah. No, I don't remember. I don't remember Roadie. 1980 is what I'm looking at here. Roadie. No, I did not see that.
Nope. If he was in it, that was the way I remember him.
But I will I will look for it, okay, Mike?
Have a good day.
All right, thank you. Make us all feel better. Yeah, but he was most famously in Fight Club and Rocky Horror Picture Show. I don't want to leave Spice World out for all the people who seem especially attached to that movie. Yeah, he was the bus driver in Spice World, I think. He was in Wayne's World.
He's played the bus driver a few times.
Yeah, he looks like a guy who wants a sedentary role.
When we were in eighth
Also, just very quickly, Scott Ian of Anthrax is married to Meatloaf's daughter. And I only know this because when I was on the air in Chicago and we had our Christmas show, and Scott Ian was in town, and so he and his wife, we got him like VIP or something like that, and I was having a brief chat with him, and he introduced me to his wife. I think I have this story correct, and I think Scott Ian's wife is Meatloaf's daughter. I think Meatloaf was his father-in-law. So who knows what kind of Meatloaf estate is getting ready to be divvied up.
And her name is Keish.
Short for Keisha.
Nope, just Keish.
I thought for sure...
like the dish.
I thought for sure that by now, Poundcake would have Googled Meatloaf's net worth. He probably didn't, because he has no idea who Meatloaf is.
I just know... At first, I thought he was the guy who had the Africa song, but that's Toto, right?
Yes, that's a man named Toto.
That's the band Toto.
That is a band called Toto, yes.
And that's what I thought Meatloaf was, and then... I was like, oh, he's probably fat and ugly, and I don't care.
Well, but some people are saying...
he was very rich.
Some people are... And I was curious about that, because he had a huge career for a while and selling albums and all that.
Only $40 million.
Oh, I'm sorry. How many millions of dollars do you have?
That's not the point. I'm not Meatloaf. And everyone was talking about his incredible net worth. I think a massive...
That's a pretty good net worth.
But for someone who has had the career that he has had, I mean, I would think... a good estate would be like $100 million at least.
At least. You're saying $100 million, which most people never
get.
Even like, famous people never get to that.
That's it.
Okay.
$40 million, I just expected more. I just expected a little more oomph, but that's okay.
That's still a lot of money. $40 million? Yeah.
I'm not saying it's not, but it's not.
You thought he was in nine-figure territory, is what you're saying. Yeah. Mary, I cut you off. What were you saying? Probably don't even remember.
Oh, no. And you were talking about Meatloaf being a bus driver in lots of different movies. And in eighth grade, we had to take this. This person came in to do like a career assessment. So we were 14 and we had to fill out like this Scantron with all these different questions. And then at the end of it, they were like personality questions and questions about things that you liked. And then at the end of it, they would tell you like what your ideal...
All right, some of those.
You know, it's weird how these things lay out because Meatloaf played a bus driver in a lot of things. Do you know who his acting coach was, Bill, for those roles?
I don't.
Paul Stanley of Kiss, who turned 70 yesterday, just a few years younger than Meatloaf. Meatloaf played all those bus driver roles, and Paul Stanley of Kiss, little known fact, I don't know if this is on Poundcake's Rolling Stone Rock Trivia a Day challenge, whatever.
Are you doing that today, by the way?
Yeah.
I hope it's a Meatloaf one.
Me too. Meat too. And Paul Stanley was his acting coach.
Here's Paul Stanley driving an RTA bus.
Yeah. Okay, that's cool. Next stop, Tower City. You got a lot of nice shops in there. You can even get you some Chinese food at the food court. I'm Paul Stanley driving a bus.
That was Paul Stanley driving an RTA bus.
Damn. Also, thank you to whoever got me hip to this because I could not remember the name of a movie I liked that had Meatloaf in it. It's called Black Dog. He did a movie in the late 90s with Patrick Swayze, where Swayze was a trucker who they blackmail into transporting guns. And Meatloaf was one of the bad guys, if memory serves.
Where does the dog come in?
That was the name of the truck.
Oh, the truck was the black dog?
Yeah, I think so. I don't remember a black dog in the actual movie.
It wasn't that literal.
It wasn't that literal. No, it wasn't. This was the theme song to the film Black Dog with Meatloaf and Patrick Swayze, 1998. Yep. Alan Poundcake is crazy. Chris Cornell's net worth was around $40 million, and he was way more famous than Meatloaf. I don't think Chris Cornell was way more famous than Meatloaf. I mean, he didn't have as long of a career. He just wasn't that old. But if you ask people who's Meatloaf and who's Chris Cornell, I love Chris Cornell, but you'd be hard-pressed to make a case that Chris Cornell was more famous than Meatloaf.
He was
just because he'd been around longer.
Yeah.
He's more famous in his circles, though. I think the people who loved Chris Cornell, like, loved him, and he was...
Well, right, but they knew who Meatloaf was, too.
And Meatloaf had... Yeah, I mean, Bat Out of Hell, I think, sold 43 million albums. Like, Meatloaf was very famous.
Yeah. Alan, people forget also that Meatloaf didn't perform for a decade and a half. Yeah, he started coming back maybe 10 years ago. Well, he's sucking down all those oxygen tanks.
He needed a reason to do it. He's like, I can't just do this at home. If I go out on the road, it doesn't look as suspect.
Plus, he and Jim Steinman were suing each other for a long time. So
that cut into their
I bet money, it did bet. A lot. Yeah. Yes. I bet he wasn't even worth $40 million at the end, if that's important to people.
It's important to Poundcake, even though he's a fat, ugly guy.
Poundcake or Meatloaf?
Meatloaf.
I'm not ugly. I may be a little chunky, but I'm not ugly.
I didn't say you were. I was just trying to figure out who he was talking about.
I'm talking about Meatloaf. He's a fat, old, ugly guy. That's what Poundcake said. So why would he care about him?
Damn, Alan, I took the same test as Mary in middle school, and they told me my ideal career was vending machine technician.
Oh, man.
This seems very heavily weighted toward blue-collar jobs. Didn't anybody get one? They were like, tech CEO. Nobody got that?
So.
It was all bus driver and vending machine. Sounds like they were trying to get people that this test was so sent out by a vocational school.
I think
was looking for people to enroll.
I think it was more to like curb your expectations, where it's like, hey, if you're gonna repair vending machines, that's cool too. You know, like just to kind of make everybody feel.
Because then you can look up and be like, oh, they actually make a pretty good living. So
right.
Maybe I'll focus on that.
Okay.
A year plus insurance. All right.
Alan, Black Dog refers to a trucker falling asleep at the wheel and hitting someone. And in that movie, Patrick Swayze's character was in jail because he did that. Oh, okay. Well, I just remember they put Prong in the soundtrack, and I friggin' love Prong. Black Dog. I'm going to watch Black Dog tonight. In honor of, because I can't sit through Rocky Horror again. In honor of not only Patrick Swayze, also dead. I don't know if you heard. And
he'd been dead for a minute.
Pardon me?
He's been dead for a minute.
But then he was a ghost.
Well, he played a ghost.
I'm sorry?
He was. He
well, yeah, because he was dead.
And then
he has to play a ghost
later.
Like he has to play a ghost. He's dead. I got a break. If you want tickets for Static X, well, they push the show till next year. But you'll have those tickets. House of Blues, March 2023. The Fear Factory, I think. But I dig that band. So a couple of tickets for you to see Static X after this break. And then 4:30 is the next chance for you to grab some money. I'll have $1,000 for you and a keyword for you to go fund to yourself.
It's the Alan Cox Show.